Okay, good morning, everyone. Thank you very much, Yves, for the introduction and to be present with us today to show the determination also of the Executive Board and the Governing Council to enhance, I would say, a new generation of RTGS services. We are here today so to have discussion with you. This is not the last time. This is more the first time, not the first time, but let's say a new generation of... Speak louder, okay. So it's a new generation of, I would say, discussion we want to open with you. As you have seen, we have issued a consultation paper to discuss what we call Vision 2020. Vision 2020 should not be taken as an end date of a process, but more as a medium-term perspective on how we can develop a new generation of RTGS services, as explained by Yves. Different facets of our infrastructure is being looked at. We have two main, I would say, angle of attack here that we are following. On one end, we want to be efficient, cost efficient, technically efficient. So to increase our efficiency, this comes as a first given, as Yves just said, by looking at how we can gather synergies from T2S, enhancement to the platform of the 4CB, to take them to the same level of services for Target 2 and to see how we can capitalize on those services. And for that purpose, we'll have a first part dedicated on technical issues that will be presented by Marco Pieroni from the 3CB, 4CB, I mean the master behind the screen almost for all those systems. We'll present all these technical enhancements that we can bring and all what we can expect as a main driver, I would say, to drive this technical element. The second axis we are looking for is innovation also. So how do we, Eurosystem, we market infrastructure in Europe, can benefit from innovations which are coming now. So we speak a lot of DLT and new technology of this one. But also beyond this, there is a lot of services that we can enhance. So the way our system can be resilient, the way our system can be strong against cyber threat, the way our system can develop services which are state of the art so that our economy can work as smooth as possible. We mentioned instant payment also, which could be a way to make it work better. So I don't want to repeat the speech just before, just to say that we are moving in the Eurosystem. Last week, the Governing Council decided to adapt the governance structure of Target 2 into a new governance context, taking the lessons from the past, having what we call committees and board format to steer products and projects in the Eurosystem. So a market infrastructure board has been established, a bit on the image of the T2S board, to take over the responsibility on the future of Target 2, both the operation of the product service Target 2, if you want, and also the future developments, which will have to be taken out of the consultation exercise we are conducting now. While the committee, PSCC, has been renamed and changed to MIPC, Market Infrastructure and Payment Committee, focusing on the two other elements that Yves presented, which are more the catalyst function of the Eurosystem and the oversight function. So there is a clear separation now in our governance structure on the steering on one end of product and projects, and on the other end of the steering of our policy and oversight activities. So this gives us also a new energy to discuss today this part, which will fall clearly under the steering of the market infrastructure board as soon as we will have materialized clear project on how to go. And the main topic of today, obviously, is what concerns directly the RTGS services. So we are looking forward for this. One element I would like to have during the day, if possible, is to have as much as possible interaction with you. One of our challenges is to see how to interact. We have seen also as one, I think, of the positive outcome of the process of doing T2S, and I see some friendly face of T2S in the room, that the interaction we had with the market brought all the quality and the capacity we had to handle challenges as we are going along the project. I am sure going to those big projects to reform RTGS services will bring some challenges, and we will have to discuss with you to see the best way to remedy them. So it's not only inside central bankers' discussion that we can resolve everything. We need your help. so that you can help us to steer in a good direction the project, even though the steering is our clear responsibility and we will take our responsibility. So any feedback on your side on how to improve or further develop the way we can interact with you in the field of payments, in the field of RTGS services, would be also welcome. This also says that today the session is organized in, let's say, three big presentations, which are presenting the three big chapters of the consultation process we have. So I will introduce them as we go. First, Marco will come to present, as I mentioned, the technical, I would say, chapter of the services. Please interact straight away during the presentation. Don't hesitate to interrupt, to ask questions. Marco, Sylvain, and Patrick, the speakers, will be even happy if this happens, not at all shocked. And also, they will try to steer a bit also from you some reaction. We have some, I understand, voting devices that we have here. So eventually, you can give real-time feedback, and we can comment on those feedback as we go along the day. So make it a lively day, even though it's a bit formal conference room with a cinema processing. You should not feel ashamed to speak, wave hand, and interact with us. I think that's all for the moment of what I can say. So I will ask Marco Pieroni if he can join us. And again, thank you very much, Yves, for your presence today with us. Hein? Marco?
Good morning to everyone. My name is Marco Pieroni. I'm here on behalf of the 3CB/4CB, that, as I said, by slash Banca d'Italia, or whatever, slash Eurosystem, and to the three central banks that developed TARGET2 and operate TARGET2, and with the help now of Banco de España that joined the club for T2S, we operated both the two platforms. Just a few words on TARGET2. TARGET2 system went live in 2007. And some of the components, based on the experience of Banque de France, Bundesbank, and Banca Italia on managing former RTGS system, then some of these components is coming from early, was developed early 2000. They served, TARGET2 served 4 years with outstanding performance in terms of availability and customer satisfaction. But there is for sure a need to have some modernization here. And for this point of view, the Vision 2020 aims to modernize, one of the aims of the Vision 2020 is to modernize the technical infrastructure of the system in several components with aim to reduce the costs. Most of the change will be transparent for the user. For this point of view, we are talking about technical infrastructure change, will be transparent for the user, some others not. And the consultation aims, as I said, by the chairperson here, aims to start this dialogue with the user for the aspect where the user are impacted. My presentation, then, we will focus on the most relevant aspect of the modernization, that is namely the Eurosystem Single Gateway, and all the factors, the enabling factors that will allow to achieve this objective. The Eurosystem System Gateway aims to explore, is one of the results of the possible synergies between T2 and T2S, especially in the area of technical consolidations. The main purpose of this technical consolidation, to be frank, is to decrease the running cost, and they have some aspect in terms of internal changes on the overall platform. Then we will consolidate the subsystems inside the system. Now, between TARGET2 and T2S, we have several technical subsystems that are duplicated. Now, in this project, we try to merge them in order to achieve saving in terms of cost and increase also the resilience of the system. Another area where we think to act is to not to reduce the availability of the number of test systems, but to concentrate them without, also in this case, without impact on the user side. One of the areas where we can take really advantages for the state of art of technology that was introduced in T2S is exactly this European, this Eurosystem single gateway, that they need some enabling factors in order to be built. One is the migration to the ISO 20022. The second one is the possibility to access the platform by a different network service provider. That is a possibility that has been opened for T2S. And the third, but not less important, is to enhance the information security, also to comply with the new guidance on the cyber resilience. Then we start with the resistance certificate gateway that aim to fully modernize the market infrastructure, to deliver a common market infrastructure service that can potentially serve multiple market infrastructure that the Eurosystem are going to provide, and Target2, T2S, but others. The principle based on to have a single access services, to have agnostic technical connectivities, possibility to be accessed via multiple network, and that's everything will be based on common protocols. Then will be a technical constraints here to enhance the harmonized GUI, graphical user interface, between this market infrastructure and strong authentication mechanism. Which are the expected benefits of the Eurosystem Gateway? First of all, as I already mentioned, is to reduce the running cost with the sharing of the same connectivity and security components. That will allow also to reuse the same components for further projects that come in the field. And what will be what we expect to be the benefit for the user, and that you can use the same connectivity services to access to the different market infrastructure provided by the Eurosystem. Now, I believe that every one of you knows the architecture of Target2 and maybe something also of T2S, but just a few words to remember which is the current landscape for Target2. From the user side, I mentioned here three categories of users that are central banks, credit institutions, and the so-called low volume participants that are credit institutions that access Target2 only for a few number of payments, for which the Eurosystem developed a special few years ago, a special channel on internet, using internet channels. All the others, central bank, credit institution, this is the main channel, access via application to application and user to application, the two modalities available in Target2, access to the system through SWIFT, that is the unique service provided for Target2. In addition, the central bank, for some special purpose, can access the system via user to application using a core net, that is the Eurosystem in a closed network, a wide area network that interconnect all the central banks. It's not open to the external. All these channels are managed by a single interface that route the payments the messages, the interaction to the modules of Target2. Here I mention only two modules that are relevant for the credit institution, the payment modules and the home accounting module, but exist other modules in the platform like the contingency module that we'll come back on this later, and the CRSS, the statistical services, the reserve management module, and the standing facility modules. These modules are available only for central banks. This is instead, in this picture, this slide represented the current landscape for T2S, and you can see the situation is very, very much different. Here, the users, then means the central, the CSD, the central security depository, and the direct connected participant that are customer in some way, or user of the contract with the CSD, but they have decided to use the possibility in T2S to access directly the system. That's the DCP and the CSD can access in two ways, as usual using A2A and U2A, or only using U2A. The network now is not provided by a single provider, but a tender was launched by the Eurosystem. The license was given to two network providers that won the tender, SWIFT and SIA Colt. In addition, there is a link between Target2 and T2S. It was built on using another network, and that is the 4CB network, that is an internal network between the central bank, between the providing central banks, and that is used also for the business continuity purpose, in order to replicate the data and between the different sites where the platform running, T2S platform running. Having this landscape in mind, what is T2S? What is T2? This is the general idea. What could be the potential architecture for this European single gateway? On the user side, we have now all the market infrastructure participant of T2 and T2S and potentially other market infrastructure. That means a central bank, CSD banks, and all the other eligible institutions that can access this system. The idea is to replicate the model of T2S, because I mean, what I say, this is more modern we take the advantages of the technology that we developed for T2S. And then for here, it's envisaged also to have the possibility to have a multiple network service provider. Here I mentioned two, NSP1 and NSP2. Plus the internet channel, but we will that is still possible. I mean, the Eurosystem system gateway will be capable to provide also this channel. But maybe we come back on this later on in the next slide. What will be based this European service in a number of services? First of all, the connectivity services. This is, as I said, will be provided by a selected number of network service providers. Of course, at this stage, we didn't have any discussion or any idea how to this network provider will be selected. And it's something is an open point that will be for sure discussed in the next months or years. Each network service provider should be able to connect. This is a very important principle also that must be, in any case, followed, whatever is the approach to select the network service provider, that it should be able to connect every market participant to the Eurosystem infrastructure without any barrier to the entrance, and support the most important services that we use, that means U2A, A2A, store and forward, as well as real-time services. The functionalities that have to support from connectivity point of view are, I will not go through all of them, but simply I put it there only to mention that are exactly the same like the one that are used in T2S. Then that is normally even larger than the one that are currently available in Target2. As I said, there is also the Eurosystem Single Gateway, which would also capable to provide the internet connection. And it was developed for low volume participants in Target2. It was actually quite a success, but was built in hurry and also with the low cost, we can say, approach, without, of course, compromise on securities, but the performance are not so, I mean, outstanding, we can say. And the services that potentially the internet channel can provide is the access to the web portal, because the idea in this Eurosystem system gateway is to have a web portal where at least the security aspects are exactly the same, that you don't need to use, maybe today you have to use several security devices to access to Target2 and T2S. There will be one common devices, one common way to access to this web portal. And then from functional point of view, instead, the needs of the different market infrastructure will be separated. There is no need, there is no technical needs to have exactly the same information. And harmonization is, of course, welcome. It would be possible to, if it's mandatory, to have security authentication via public key infrastructure, as well as it's possible to have a found download and upload. But this is the small sentence that I put in red at the end of the slide. It's quite important because the opportunity to maintain this internet-based connection should be reassessed also in light of the cyber security requirements. I mean, the system is weak as well as is the weaker point is of the connection is. I mean, for sure, the interconnection is the weaker, could be the weaker point of the chain. Then even if the users are only the maybe small banks somewhere, but through this channel, it could be attacks to the platform can be performed. Then I mean, does not care only for the low volume participant, but care also from big institution to know if exists or does not exist the channel, because could endanger the resilience of the wall or the wall infrastructure. From the other side, we have to mention, please.
To say that the question of internet is quite important and quite interesting as well, because indeed we are facing a dilemma here. Because on the one hand, it's very important for us not to build our new TGS only for big players. It's also important not to create technical or legal hurdle towards small participants. We also want to have small participants in our system, because the system is made for the implementation of the monetary policy, and if we have only the big players, then it has an impact on the implementation of monetary policy. So we need to implement technical solutions which are affordable and manageable also by small participants. That's what we have achieved. That was already 5-6 years ago with the internet, but also, and that's the other part of the dilemma, I would say, is it reasonable to consider maintaining an internet-based connection on times where the cyber resilience is so high on the agenda of the operators and of the regulators? So that's basically the type of dilemma we will have to solve. And if not internet, I would say, or if the outcome of our investigation and also the feedback that we would receive from the market shows that the internet is not the technical solution, at least we would have to make sure that there is a way for small participants to easily connect to the system. That's absolutely key, again, for the implementation of monetary policy, which is the raison d'être of our TGS.
No, perfectly, Sylvain, exactly. There is two factors that are in this direction, because, I mean, if you want to increase the resilience of the internet connection, we have to become the internet connection very, very near to a network service provider. Then that would increase also the cost to maintain this channel. On the other side, we will see a couple of slides after, the possibility to have additional players, additional two, three, or whatever will be, the number of network service providers will decrease the cost of the connectivity. Then, these two factors really are important to take in consideration in order to decide what, if keep or not to keep this internet connection. What I mean, and nowadays means the internet connection, a connection managed by the Eurosystem via internet. That's what we can say in this way. Then, what are the protocol and standard that the Eurosystem Gateway will support? As usual, also here is mainly based on what has been already developed for T2S. Then for the application-to-application channel, it will be a message-based communication protocol. Based on XML format for messages and file that can transport, on top of that, also fully standard ISO 22 messages, but does not mean that it's mandatory to be 22. Also in T2S, we have some special communication, for instance, for reports that we provide XML format, even not in full in standard ISO. That is also important for the Target 2 world, where the discussion that we have had regarding the migration to the delay of the migration to ISO, it was decided to use a standard that is not really fully ISO. Built using the ISO methodology, but not fully ISO-based. Then from technical perspective, what is important for us is XML. As regards the standard, I believe Sylvain will discuss later on more on the real standard part and with the opportunity that ISO will bring to Target2 community. The transfer protocol will be based on a new protocol that was developed on purpose with Target2, that is the DEP protocol, Data Exchange Protocol, that is used to pay attention only between the communication between the gateway of the platform and the gateways of the selected national service provider. Then it's completely transparent for you, because you will use in T2S, the community use, of course, the standard method of access, the standard way to access provided by the network service provider. But that is translated to this internal protocol. That is also an advantage we will see in terms of cybersecurity. We will see later on. As regards the user to application way, it will be based on standard HTTP channel to connect the end user workstation with the web portal. The authentication service will be used via accredited PKI infrastructures. not only one, of course. And then you can access to the web application GUI provided by the market. Then the functional content of the GUI will be in the end of the different market infrastructure. Is of course very much welcome as the possibility to have a common presentation and usability, but is not a technical requirement. Okay, security services, of course, that is also something that will a fundamental part that we'll provide, nothing special here to mention, only that, again, also here we'll take the advantages of what we gain with T2S in terms of authentication, confidability, and whatever, to have a fully-fledged and a sound security framework also in this system. Now we come to what is more... difficult points, of course, because in order to build this Eurosystem Security Gateway, there are some constraints to be understood, and some enabling factor that we have to implement. Already mentioned before that the TARGET2 is outsourced to a single provider, now is Swift, that provides not only connectivity options, not only connectivity itself, connectivity service, but also some additional services, add-value services like closed user group, identification, authentication, the standard directory service. I will mention here also the white copy model to transfer the message. For the one that are not familiar with the white copy, it's a service provided by Swift where a sender send a message addressing directly the receiver, but Swift intercepted the message and then send the content of the message, or at least the relevant part of the content of the message, to the central institution that authorizes the payment, and if it's a payment message, and then send back to Swift. Swift, when I receive the authorization of the central institution, will provide to the receiver with even additional information like the settlement time and so on. This white copy system, of course, will not possible to be completely replicated in multi-vendor architecture, because it's by definition something not really proprietary, but required to have a single network service provider. T2S instead, as we already said, provides source to network service provider, and the license agreement will expire on June 2022. That is something that we have to see how to manage, but as you say, today we do not speak about how the providers will be selected. The development of the common gateway require also probably a new tender procedures for the new license. And another important constraint that the need for to use XML format. That will be an important change for the TARGET2 user. Currently, the TARGET2 user are mostly for the 19, not for the 100%, but for most of the payments use FIN standard and FIN protocols and all the FIN procedures. Only for the, that is quite a relevant part in any case of T2S, then ancillary system interface, then the interface vis-à-vis CSD, ACH, CLS, etc. This XML standard is already in place also for TARGET2. Then we come to the next slide. We come to the opportunities and the challenges that we have with the migration to ISO 20022. That is already the preferred choice for the new market infrastructure around the world, also for payment services. The benefit of the migration has been already thoroughly evaluated together with the TARGET2 community a couple of years ago. We have had several discussions. At the end, commonly we agreed that was not the time to implement in the 2017. It was, if I don't mistake, Sylvain, the implementation date. But also in consideration of the vision, that was delayed. But now I believe what is written actually in the consultation report, that the consolidation infrastructure is the right moment for a fully fledged implementation ISO 20022 in 22 in the also in the TARGET2 world. On the more technical side, I mean, I repeat here, maybe Sylvain will say for sure more regarding which kind of standards will be implemented, how to approach the standard itself, but there is nevertheless a number of technical topics that will be important to discuss jointly with you. Some of them has been already addressed during previous discussion on the migration, but maybe it needed to be revised, or the solution that we found that time, maybe we need to revise it now. One of them is the how to manage the message versions, of course. There is already some proposal in the standard, and we have to see if are still valid, or we have to review that. Message version, sorry for the one that are not particularly familiar or enthusiastic, is standard, is like the MT 103, the customer payment, and then there is two version, MT normal MT 103 and the STP version, as well as for the interbank payments, there is 202 is the messaging fin, then there is also the version 202 cov. I mean, all these kind of peculiarities must be, of course, translated in some way also in the ISO, in the new ISO messages. There would be a need to have a discussion together how the release management is done, no? The release, the way we are used from years, maybe more than 20 years, for the how the SWIFT manage the release on fin, in very, I mean, now it's, we can say, very consolidated way. Every body of us want to have the certainty in the life. For me, one certainty that in November there will be a SWIFT release on fin. Then it's, I am quite, I know what I have to do every November from 20 years. Now with ISO, we have less technical constraints, in the sense that we do not be technically forced to have all the release every time in November, but it's something that we have to agree and possibly to find a common solution on that. Potentially, there is also the possibility to keep, if still needed, some of the features of the white copy in the V-shape model that will be used instead in the European System Gateway. V-shape because it's V-shape, because the message is sent from the user directly to the gateway, and then the answer will be sent from the gateway to the receiving users. Here, we can discuss if still some of the reason why the white copy is used is are still necessary. I mean, the features of the white copy were, one of the most important one was to do not send the confidential information to the central institution. But that's actually not used in TARGET2 because the full message is copied to TARGET2. Other two potential advantages then can study together if still the need are really needed is end-to-end authentication. In the white copy system, the message are signed by the sender, and the receiver can check the signature of the sender. In the V-shape, it will be not possible without study some solution. And the other possibility, the address. The other feature is the addressing. I mean, when the white copy, you address directly the receiving, then you can use the same message that you build for your correspondent banking application to decide to route at the last moment to the market infrastructure, still use the corresponding banking channels. Another area where it would be a very difficult discussion, I believe, because there is some we already have in the past, is the usage of the extension of the standard. The ISO 200.022 envisaged the possibility to add to the normal body of the message also some extension that are piece of the message that contain other information, normally for routing purpose or for security. This is used in the security world in general. Then all the messages that are standardized in the security world use the business application either. That is also the solution applied in T2S. All the messages in T2S use the business application either. And the target, where in the cache side, there was a decision not to use this business application header. And therefore, for instance, TARGET2, the connection between TARGET2 and T2S was developed in the way to add from T2, we'll add this business application header when discussed with, then in some way shield the customer for this from this additional complexity. This is something that probably will be needed to be used if you are going to this consolidation in a single gateway. The last point, the technical point to be addressed and discussed together is the addressing, of course. We found solution already during the discussion on the migration, previous discussion on migration of TARGET2 to ISO, but we have to view to see if are still valid, and mainly it's the problem of the conversion between the big and the distinguished name. And I mean, this is sorry, very technical issue, but it's quite important for the developers and the impact they can have also on the back office applications. Any question? Already?
Yes.
Oh, thank you. Take a rest.
I don't know. There is a microphone. Yes, Antonia. Thank you, Antonia.
Thank you very much for the presentation so far. One question is obviously, so with all these technical changes proposed, what is the time horizon of making such an implementation or consolidation of platform? Was that the wrong question to ask?
No. But that's as usual is the right one and the most difficult to answer for us.
I think a point which needs to be clarified is because either Mr. Mersch or Mark, you made reference to Vision 2020. It's clear that the 2020 shall not necessarily be taken literally. The naming that we used was more like to highlight the brainstorming dimension of the discussion. So let's build the RTGS system of the next decade or next decades. So that's a bit what we had in mind. So we shall not, or you shall not expect that on the 1st of January 2020, something will be delivered. Now, I think that at this stage of the discussion, it's certainly premature to give you any date indication. We are really in what we call the pre-project phase. We have some ideas, as Marco has already highlighted, in technical terms, in functional terms, or in business terms, which we are going to show throughout the day. We have to collect the feedback of the market before we come with some more concrete dates or indicative dates. So I would say that's part of the iterative process, but that's not something that we are going to cover explicitly today. Now, however, there is a point that perhaps on which perhaps you could also contribute, is the question of how should this strategy for the next generation of targets should be organized? Shall we deliver in tranches somehow or in different parts? Or would you expect that it's delivered perhaps a bit later, but in one single block to, for instance, minimize the adaptation on your side? And I would say it's part of the debate, but there is nothing really ready to be presented to you. That would be strange that at this stage of the project, we can already give you a date. That would mean somehow that we have anticipated the conclusion of the analysis.
Thanks very much. I'm really not looking for a date, but I'm looking for the substance or the magnitude of the project, okay? So I'm sure in the panel debate in the afternoon, we'll definitely going to discuss, so what is the magnitude of this? Because as you know, the financial industry is under hard pressure to implement a lot of other regulatory changes or systemic changes. So to be concrete here, it's important that we go forward in very concrete terms. So what are we talking about in terms of perhaps man hours to develop some of these technical changes? I don't know, and I don't understand. I understand what you're saying, but there will probably be quite a lot of technical engineers here to get this going. So that's one thing. And then, sorry to say, but the cost side of it, you mentioned it in the beginning of the presentation, having a lower, running with a lower cost going forward after consolidation, we need to get to grips with, so what is that really? So where do we see the cost change?
Yes, there is.
That was also a question. So where do you see that? So are we talking about 10, 20%, 30% lower cost running?
I'm curious to hear your answer, Marco.
Yes, it's very difficult to answer. On the first point, just to complement what has been said by Sylvain, there are some constraints, of course. I mean, we cannot give you now a precise time horizon, but there is some constraint. Some steps to be performed. For instance, all the internal changes that I didn't show here because it's completely no interest of you, will be no impact on you, but will be quite important. For our point, sorry, no impact. We cannot exclude there will be some impacts in terms of testing or support, but okay, it should be extremely limited. That can be performed as a first step, because that is more internal part of the Euro system. It is a sort of prerequisite to go to the second step, that is a consolidate from technological point of view of the external interface. That will be where you are starting to be involved. And then probably as a third step, there is the functional changes and more that's I believe are the three steps. Then now it will be part of the discussion of to have a single program or to have to divide in pieces, small pieces in several projects. That is part of the analysis that we are performing. As regards the cost...
Just Marco, maybe yes, sorry. To follow up on this, I mean, we will discuss further this during the panel this afternoon, certainly. But it's exactly the purpose of the discussion with you. We have no hidden agenda. What is clear is the motto we had at the beginning. What I try to say, and I think Yves, and just Sylvain repeat, we see two challenges ahead of us. And I speak here not as a central bank provider of services, but more as a community, financial services. The first one is to remain cost efficient in an economy which is globalizing and where we need to be competitive in Europe. So we need to attract investment in Europe to be able to make the economy functioning as smoothly as possible and efficiently without being imposed by standard coming from other side of the ocean, to be very clear. And the second one is innovation driven, and it is the same. If we don't do anything or if we don't adapt sufficiently our, I would say, foundation, the plumbing, the central plumbing of the market to support innovation that you, market, will develop, not us, but that we need to support, again, we will be to wait what is coming from Silicon Valley or elsewhere, and they will impose us their standards, and we will have to pay the price of this, like we pay today, maybe in some field of, I don't know, card payments, for instance. So we have to look forward for the future. That's the point. But we are not there to make project for the fun of making project. I can tell you to get project, to get motivated the governing council, to give funds to finance development, it's not easy. So we need to know exactly what you need, what we need as a community, and then we will see. So I would say it can be very big at the end, or it can be nothing if we consider that there is nothing to do. I do not believe it. That's why I'm here today. But... there is no pre-cook agenda, in a way. Huh? So there is a business opportunity to see for Europe in being modern in the field of payment and market infrastructure. So the discussion is open. Again, please go ahead. Don't hesitate to say what you agree or disagree. But let's see for the panel this afternoon. Maybe it will be interesting.
It will definitely be interesting, yeah. I fully share your point, definitely.
Yeah.
But it's important to stay concrete as we go forward.
Yes, absolutely.
With the cost pressure we see in the financial sector.
Just to answer your point, the point to be concrete for us will be July, more or less. So we are in a phase of brainstorming with you. So we are trying to shape things. We have ideas, again. That's why you see presentation with slides. It's not decision, it's ideas only. We are pressing Marco to be more efficient, as you have understood. So both from T2S and Target2 side, being an outstanding provider in services is not enough. You have to be also extremely efficient in the current world, so economically in particular. But it's time to say things, to speak, and then we will have indeed to streamline and to see what is worth to do and not to do eventually.
Okay, then but this last part is matter also requirements that will come, and we will see how we efficient and which kind of requirement will arrive. And starting also on this another enabling factor for the European system gateway, this can be seen as an objective in itself. I mean, as been mentioned before by Mr. Merch, that there are some regulatory pressure also on this area, and also some advantages that unseen in other market infrastructure to have multiple network providers also in terms of resilience. And this is the other objective, is the independence vis-à-vis the network service provider. We already said that Target2 is heavily relying on proprietary service from SWIFT, where T2S is agnostic. And then the VISO 2020 strategy really aim to see that is also the right moment to allow Target2 to become network agnostic too. Which are the benefits that we see on this this approach is the what we already seen in T2S. I mean, the competition amongst network providers reduce the cost for transfer of this payment. That was, I mean, something that is public because all the evidence are public. We agree to have a maximum cost for all the connectivity service, but you have the possibility to, you have had, and the T2S user have had the possibility to negotiate further discount based on traffic or whatever other consideration. And that would also the possibility to increase the overall resilience of the system, and then because the participant could use or choose any provider, and even in theory both. I mean, there will be no technical barrier for this point of view. And also what we expect is that will be a lower technical entry barrier for eligible participants connecting to Target2. That's what I mentioned before regarding to take in consideration regarding the internet connection. That would be one of the possibility in order to evaluate if internet connection is still needed or not. Now I'm going to end my presentation on the cyber security, cyber resilience, these are a few slides on this area. This is mainly based, of course, which will be the new guidance of the CPMI IOSCO, and the principle, the new guidance on the cyber security, focus also on two important key principles that are in the document of 2012, and the most relevant principle that is the capability to enhance the cyber resilience in order to limit the increased risk that a cyber threat poses to the smooth operation of the market financial infrastructure. And the most relevant principle stemming for the original PFMI for the cyber resilience is that the FMI, the financial market infrastructure, and Target2 and T2S should provide a clear and certain final settlement at the end of the day, and moreover should be designed in order to assure that it can resume operation in 2 hours in any event, and in any case to close the settlement operational day for the end of day settlement. That are the two key principles. But the guidance also changed a little bit the perspective, and it's quite interesting from this point of view. Then, I mean, the risks are more or less the same, are already present today. But the nature of the threat is really increasing in the terms that we now facing with highly motivated attackers that are use a very highly sophisticated means. I mean, everybody have read on the newspaper, some incident happened in central banks outside Europe. And therefore, it's not anymore to think in the way that what if, no? That's normally the way also, I must admit, over years, also our, as a Eurosystem, say, okay, what happened if? Now, the problem is what we ask ourselves, what happened when will happen? I mean, the problem that we do not have I believe it's really a change of mentality that also will impose us to move from an approach based maybe on checklists that are always the same, improved over the time, to build really an intelligence process that gather and analyze the cyber threat information in order to anticipate such kind of attacks, in order to understand how these enemies will operate and try to attack us. There are in the guidance a number of challenges, we can say, or requirements to be guidance, as I say, to be followed. And just to mention, I enumerate here the most technical one. Of course, there is also all the aspects related to the governance that are not covered here. Just to highlight some of them, for instance, gold the copy of critical data, that is something that you have to think about. Because now the infrastructure of Target2 and T2S is based on the same, on the business continuity. It's a really high and very high cost also a business continuity measure, because the data are replicated in many sites, and 4-6 sites if you count also the statistical information. 6 sites that are replicated, each site, 6 regions, 6 sites spread over 3 different regions. But that could be paradoxically a problem, because replicate this data, if there is a cyber attack and there is, for instance, malicious software installed in the system, that will automatically spread over all the infrastructure. Then we have to rethink also this kind of, there is an opportunity now with the Vision 2020 also to rethink to further improve this possibility. A golden copy is one of the opportunities. Golden copy is a place where you save the data, and possibly also with the source code. Then in potential very disruptive case, you can able to even to restart completely, almost from scratch, your system. Layered protection, that is another important feature, in order that you have to segregate as much as possible in order to have the possibility to contain the attack in some areas. And from this point of view, the architecture of Eurosystem Gateway is very good from this point of view, because now we have another segregation, apart from the internal segregation in the platform between the different DMZ and so on, there will be also a segregation between the network service provider and the core system, because in the middle there is another layer. Then there is a possibility to have another layer at the security, then you can interrupt the attack in several places. Other very important measure that you can mention is the, you have to improve, of course, detection, response, recoveries, and the as well as other functionality. All these kind of things, I'm looking just for the, you mentioned the next one, you know, the CERT and SOC, that I will also explain which is the acronym means. It's Computer Emergency Response Team that can evolve in a security operational center. It's something that means that you have this proactive approach to the security, and you build people that monitor in the system 24 hours a day from security point of view. You do not rely only on the technical monitor. These people that really look at it is something that costs a lot of money. That is, you cannot compromise on the security, as always said, of course, but also you cannot become paranoid. That is something that we have to balance. Just a last word to say that in any case, T2 and T2S are already well equipped from this point of view. I already mentioned all the business continuity model, but also another, now going to conclude my presentation, another feature that we have in TARGET2 that I believe is worth to keep also for in the future TGS system is the contingency module. In TARGET2 exists a contingency module that is based with a completely different system, the completely different setup. It's a completely different code, so it's a completely different system. It's from technical perspective, respect to TARGET2. For the moment, the contingency module can perform in emergency situation, aims to cover the gap in case of a regional disaster, because we have this 2 hours gap, but for some of the critical business of TARGET2, 2 hours even too much. Therefore, there is a possibility to activate this contingency module for a limited number of transactions, limited because they will be managed via the central banks, there will be intermediation of the central banks and manually. This is something that maybe we can bring attention in our discussion to improve this contingency module, because that will be the only one effective measure vis-à-vis a cyber, really a catastrophic cyber attack. Because business continuity, as we said, and you have had an exercise with some of you already participating in the Eurosystem, demonstrated not be useful. Instead, contingency mode is completely separate, different technical application, and then maybe with a little improvement, a little cost will give a lot of benefit to improve the resilience of the whole system. Then I finished, that was the last slide, then still I have some question, and the facts, the face of this girl, ladies, is much more or less looks like also your face, some of you are perplexed.
Thank you very much, Marco. So I have a question, yes, please, Antonia.
Thank you, so Edouard Berthet from BNP Paribas. So in light of what you explained in terms of service enhancement, attractivity, user experience, do you intend to review the access criteria to the system compared to today? So that's my first question. My second question, sorry, I have three. My second question is, I didn't see ancillary systems in your slides. So do you believe there are users as well of the system? But I didn't see ancillary systems and whether we need to improve or not. The third question is, do you intend to offer a file exchange? I mean, today in TARGET2 it's one-by-one messages. Tomorrow, do you intend to offer the capacity to receive bulk files with multiple messages for payments in the future of TARGET2?
Okay, Sylvain?
At least for the first one, the eligibility criteria, let's say it's more legal issue most of the time than a functional or business issue, in the sense that the SFD, so the Settlement Finality Directive under which we are operating our systems, does not give a lot of possibility, I would say, for expanding the eligibility criteria, in particular towards non-banks. And most of the time, that has been the legal obstacle that we have faced. However, we aim at having at collecting replies in this consultation, not only from the current participants, but also from the would-be participant or from the institution that today have made the choice not to be participant or cannot be participant on the basis of the current eligibility criteria. So I would say, so far in the last years, we have not been confronted to a lot of requests from this last category of institutions that are forbidden to connect to Target. So that's why we are not anticipated any big discussion in that direction. But I would say, depending on the feedback that we receive, we don't exclude also tackling this more policy discussion, but keeping in mind the legal constraint that exists stemming from the SFT. There were in particular some years ago a debate that we had, or the question that came with regard to payments institution, which if you take today the SFT would forbid any designated system under the SFD to accept them as participants, just to give you an illustration of the limitation or the legal limitation that we have.
Maybe yes. If I can answer on the second question regarding the ancillary system. No, I didn't mention the ancillary system in order to not complicate so much the picture, but the second reason is because the ancillary system in Target 2 are already connected via an interface that there is no technical impact to move to your system gateway, because it's already based on XML. Then we can easily, the migration will be smoother than the ancillary system are definitely in the picture, but there is no, I mean, the technical challenge here are really much less relevant. And as regards the files, of course, the Euro System Gateway itself will be able to manage also the file like in T2S. I mean, the most of the traffic in T2S is managed by files. Then, but if you want to use the files in Target 2, in the sense that not the files, but to bulk payment that are transported on a file, that is a functional question. Then I'm happy to leave to Sylvain.
No, but as always, that's something that has to be taken from the demand side. So, did you have any particular business case in mind for the bulk? Because you have to acknowledge that it's not necessarily very intuitive in the context of an RTGS system to interact with the participant using files. It's more something that you would find perhaps in the retail or ACH world, a bit less in the world of RTGS, where by nature we settle immediately and immediate finality and one by one. And that's the G in the RTGS. But do you have any particular example in mind or business case?
No, I mean, it's just whether you want to offer this service or not, this possibility. I mean, it will depend on each institution, whether they want to exchange by file. The idea behind is more on the cost side. Or normally, when you exchange files instead of message by message, it could be cheaper than with the files than compared to message to message. Now, it's a question of business case and depend of each institution, I mean. So.
But I would say we see it more as a demand-driven than offer-driven, because I would say handling file and settling transactions which are batched in a file, that's something that we do already for the ancillary system. So I could imagine that the marginal cost to offer that service beyond the ancillary system also to the banks is not something that would be out of proportion. So it's really more demand-driven, and that's a very good point.
Maybe whether you will still offer retail payments into the system.
That's a very
commercial
relevant.
Payments.
That's
so, I mean,
very
maybe
relevant.
It's linked to that and the second pillar. So
That's a very relevant question, which is key in our financial equation, I have to say. And that's something which is going to be tackled this afternoon in the panel.
Well, you will have the possibility to give your input, obviously. Yeah, and also, I guess, Patrick, you will mention ancillary system later in your presentation. So maybe there will be more element there. Is there other question for this first presentation? Yes?
Yeah. Domenico?
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. Domenico Scafidi, Target and Working Group member. First of all, thank you for this important workshop, sharing with us the new Target 2 and the futures. My question is related to...
this is only the technical part.
My question is related to a technical issue. I have seen a slide, I think that Marco to introduce. And it's related to the new way to calculate the big code. I think that it's not from Swift, but from ISO. And you know, in 2000, when we talk about 2017, we talk about the different way to distinguish big code. I think that we have to bear in mind the different way to calculate the new regulation to calculate the big code. I think that is going live at the end of the year on 2017. Maybe Swift can help us to understand better what is going on.
Thank you, Mimo. That is something that is always in the radar, but I do not see more from strategic point of view, for tactics point of view. That's probably will affect already the current Target 2 system more than the future the future one. And we are analyzing the technical impact from the platform itself, but for sure we have to something that we have to maybe bring to the attention of the our groups and in order to discuss if there is an impact also for your side in terms of need of testing and so on. Thank you. That's a very valid point.
Thank you.
Yeah, Marcello.
Marcello, yeah. We are resilient, you see.
Thank you. Marcello Topa from Citi. Just to follow up on Edward's question and your answer about the eligibility criteria, I wanted to maybe extend the analysis of this topic to the question of that was mentioned, instant payments. I don't know whether this is going to be covered in later presentations, but when in my mind we put those two topics together, we are potentially looking at instant payments also in a sort of peer-to-peer mode between the end users, so opening to retail business even. So the question is there any sort of a plan or aspect within the vision of the next decades to for the ESG to also extend its services to non-institutional services? I'm using ESG because I don't like new T2, but we're talking about this new infrastructure. Thank you.
Yeah, maybe, I mean, the way we have organized the reflection on the way we have organized the reflection on Vision 2020 is three pillars in a certain way for the future. And we discuss only one today, which is RTGS services, if you want. So the consolidation, Target 2, T2S. We don't focus so much on the potential development of a Euro system collateral management service for us as a collateral taker to benefit, let's say, from T2S environment. And we don't also discuss too much on instant, which is considered as a separate dossier, even though some of the topics we discuss have obviously a link to it. The operating hours of Target 2, whether we need to extend or not, it's related to this. The opportunity to have a strategy which answers retail payment needs is another element, obviously, which will determine what we have to do in Target 2. To support the development of instant payment model pan-European. You have heard also in the presentation the few words of Yves that we are particularly careful not to have to face another SEPA project for the next 10 years because instant would have developed national schemes which are not interoperable. So we are discussing a lot with ACHs, and some of you are there here today, to see how interoperability can work, and if it does not work, what we have to do at the level of Target 2 to make it work. So up to where we have to go in the level of service so that it works. But there is no way we will accept to have another fragmentation being built because of the emergence of instant services. That's very clear. So indirectly, to answer to you, it's not really the main topic today, but certainly some of the answer we have to bring will have a correlation to this. Is there other question on this first technical chapter?
Otherwise, perhaps I can make a question to you or to the audience. It's in relation to the multiplicity of service providers. That's something that we put into the picture of our strategy for also for legal reasons, huh? Because when we built TARGET2, we have selected without any tender network service provider, which was at that time possible because some conditions were met, but we would consider that these conditions would not be met any longer, and that's one of the reasons why a tender would need to be made. The second reason is to increase the competition, and T2S was a very good example that the prices for the banks in terms of messages were considerably decreased. But then there is also a third dimension that has not necessarily been highlighted in the context of T2S, which is the resilience. And that goes one step further, I would say. If we have more than one service provider, and then we leave the participants, including the critical participants, to select one of the many, well, we still need to support the cost on the side of the infrastructure to be compatible with a multiplicity of service providers, but we are not increasing our resilience. Because most presumably, if one of the many service providers is failing or is interrupting its services, it will have eventually important and perhaps systemic implications on the way we are operating the platform. So we are, from a resilience viewpoint, even downgrading the situation compared to a single, one could even say. Now, what about considering as well taking that opportunity of a multiplicity of providers to increase the degree of resilience? Not necessarily for all participants, because not all participants in an RTGS system in particular have the same degree of criticality. You know, we have today in Target the concept of critical participant, which is out of 1,000 participants covering perhaps 20, or I don't have the real figure in mind, but that's around, that's this order of magnitude. But that at least for these critical actors, without which we cannot really carry on the business normally and properly, why not considering that for these actors, they would be asked not only to select one provider as the main one, but also a second one as a backup, not necessarily with the same level of service, not necessarily with the same, volume assumptions, but is it something that you would see as, of course, a cost for you, or for if you are critical in the RTGS in the short term, but would you also see benefits for the community as a whole? What would be your reaction to this type of discussions on the multiplicity of network provider and the value that we can make in terms of resilience?
So I think this this point was also tackled during the T2S project. I mean, whether we could have a backup network provider. Again, it's a question of cost, so it can be costly. My point was more, why not in the tender give some criteria in terms of selection of network provider, having the resilience within the offer of the network provider, so that we can have something which is part of the service. So, and this would solve the issue of having two providers. If you have the resilience within the provider, it solves your issues. That's my personal opinion.
That's already the case, because the for instance, just to mention the availability required to network providers for the connectivity service based on 5.9. That is, I believe, the top that is available on the market. That is, just to say that is not to, but it's already the case for T2S. That's not because, I mean, not the, it's not because, it's, Sylvain is not asking the question because believe that the current T2S service provider are not able to provide the resilient connection. That's, you know, there are other aspects of the cyber attack, for instance, not consider an attack to the network. Then it's, of course, both are resilience, but as I said before, it's not matter anymore of what if, what when. Then if it will happen, someone will succeed to attack one of the network service providers. If you have another connection, of course, you are increasing your resilience. But I said before, it's a matter also, I agree with you, it's a matter of cost and not to become paranoid. Eh? That is... but maybe sometimes you are forced to have several connections inside your institution with several network providers. And sometimes there is not so much dialogue we notice. Then you already have in your institution the connection, but you use for this specific service. Then giving the opportunity to have multiple service providers that maybe you already have in your institution, maybe in another data center, maybe not, you can think to have as improve resilience to service provider. That's definitely improve the resilience in any case. That is a fact, I believe. But depending on your institution to evaluate, is the cost are and the benefits are equal. I don't think that the idea of Sylvain is to impose something, but more to seize the opportunity.
Or the one of the logical consequences of the discussion. I mean, I think the question deserves to be raised now. It doesn't mean that the conclusion will be the one that I gave as a possible option.
As far as I know, I have to check, but as far as I know, some other market infrastructure instead impose as a rule for critical participants to this. That
RTGS system, I don't know, but some others, some other market infrastructure, yes. Could also be something that is imposed to us by oversight requirements as well.
This came in my mind, maybe if you allow me, Sylvain, just the last point on the technical side, then I believe it's time for the coffee break, as regarding the capacity and the scalability. One of the advantages of the new architecture, the Eurosystem Gateway, is that will increase dramatically the capacity, the volumes that can be managed in the system. That is, of course, we hope to receive more volume because there are more fees, and then we can recover our cost. Just to give you an idea, the current infrastructure Target 2 can manage an order of magnitude of 100,000 of messages per day. Now we are talking about several millions of messages per day with the new infrastructure, and also the possibility to escalate further. It's I cannot say unlimited, but very, 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 very high.
We have another question.
Harald Keller from UBS. You have offered that opportunity to two banks as well and T2S to select a different network provider that they had before. Now, I would like to understand how many banks have actually used this. That may give you a hint, perhaps, of what the appetite is to change network providers.
Well, let's say, if you take it from that angle, that could be a bit restrictive. Now, if you take it from that angle, you are also hiding the fact that this tendering and this competition has succeeded in considerably bringing down the fees that you are paying for the for accessing the network services. Huh? Now, on the share of the market share of the between the two providers, I don't have the figures, but I think that even if we would have the figures, they would be somehow seen as confidential ones.
Oh, I believe without a breach any confidential, that is for sure. I agree. We have the figure, of course, because I was, especially Banca Italia, have the responsibility on the Eurosystem. This is it's a specific responsibility that you have on behalf of the Eurosystem to manage the tender. Is for sure confidential. But what you can say that is not negligible. I mean, there was an effect.
A last question, perhaps, before we break for coffee, just on time. You are just in the middle, so you have to choose your camp.
So Paula Rules from Deutsche Bank. My question would be actually, given now the fact that the Fed and CHIPS announced they're going to migrate into ISO 20 or 22 as well, how far are you guys engaging each other in the dialogue? Because from an industry perspective, on my customer's perspective, here I'm talking about FI as well as corporates, they're interested in a standardized messaging, market practices, and this type of thing. The second thing would be actually we as an industry in correspondent banking globally met just end of last year to basically discuss the possibility to evaluate or evolve in correspondent banking. Now, it's a project called the Global Payment Innovation Initiatives. We are very much, you know, looking very positively towards EBA clearing and target because it is on white copy. And it's going to allow us actually to implement a track and trace capability based on white copy. Basically kind of using the opportunity of the white copy to benefit from a closed ecosystem to provide these tools. So while I totally support, and I'm absolutely one of the biggest benefits I'm seeing is indeed the migration to ISO 20022, the usage of multiple service providers might give us another challenge, which we can tackle.
On your point of the degree of collaboration with the other market infrastructure in the world, in particular the large value ones, because for the other market infrastructure, the standards would have to be different anyway because the business is different. It's a very valid question, but I'm actually explaining that in my slide just after the coffee break, so I don't want to kill the suspense or to shorten your time for the coffee break. So if you don't mind, I will be covering it just after the break. Okay, Paola?
Thank you.
Thank you.